Okay, folks, welcome back from your break. So I said at the beginning that we'd talk about some of the things that parametric equations can do that are sort of hard to do with Cartesian equations, right? You know, these sort of, what are we actually getting when we use parametric equations? What do they give us? So I want to begin by just showing kind of a funny video. Or I think it's really funny. So this is an old Buster Keaton clip. Here, I'll go back just a second earlier. So here he is. Buster Keaton was like great for visual gags, very, very, very funny. So he sits down, he's gonna relax. He's thinking about his life. Where's the train? It's just completely oblivious, just going. And he's off. So one thing that we might want to do is we might want to describe the motion that he experiences as he's sitting on this train. Right, so this would be quite hard to do with Cartesian coordinates. And he's off. So what are these points doing in Cartesian coordinates is our question. Those points on the train wheel, where is Buster going? Okay. So we're going to look at that train wheel, zoom in on it, see what's going on. Mathematically, we've got something like this going on. So we have a point on the wheel. It's tracing out a path through time. And we're going to describe the position of that rolling black dot. Okay, we're going to come up with an equation for the red curve. Okay? So this is what's called a cycloid. Taking a small step back to section 1.1, and we're going to investigate from section 1.1 this notion of cycloids. Excellent. So the cycloid is obtained by a point on the circumference of a rolling wheel. So we've got this wheel that's moving along, and we want to describe where that point is at time t. So our picture is something like this. Right, we have radius r. Our wheel starts to move in this direction. And we see that this point is tracing out some kind of curve. This curve was very motivating for a lot of problems in calculus. People knew that this curve existed. They saw rolling wheels, but they couldn't calculate many things about it. So
Galileo, for example, he wanted to calculate the area under one of those bumps. So he actually just cut a piece out of metal. He traced a cycloid, cut a piece out of metal, and weighed it to figure out the area. It's kind of cool. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to figure out the position of this point. So what we're going to do is we're going to break this down into a series of simpler movements that we understand. So the first movement is how this point moves around the circumference of the wheel. So we'll break this up into parts that we can understand and then develop from that an equation that models what's going on. So our first movement is the point relative to the center. Look at where this thing is relative to the center of the wheel. And then we'll look at the center, the position of the center relative to the ground. If we have both of these movements, we can figure out the position of the moving point. So let's first think about how far this thing travels, how far the center travels at time t. So we've got circumference radius r. Or sorry, we've got radius r. We're traveling t radians. Okay. So if we go radius r, t seconds, then we get times r. Okay, so t radians times radius r tells us how far this thing moves. So after t seconds, this part will roll down to here. Radius r, t seconds gives us rt. What's the y coordinate of the center? approximately the value of the radius. Right? The center of the wheel always stays on that same constant y height. So now, I want you to take 5 minutes, try and figure out where the point is relative to center, okay? Try and calculate out the value of number one here. If you're stuck, it's very highly suggestive up here. To point out, you're allowed to chat with your neighbor and figure this out together. Collaborative.
Okay. Thank you.